love for our movement and blow the lid on is the driving versus traveling and the private license. I saw you went there one day, and just because you were saying, where's the private license part? And they kept showing you the commercial portion of it. Because driving is commercial. I mean, I always tell people this, if you ask somebody what they do for a living and they say, I'm a driver, do you say, no, everyone's a driver?
When you think about it, when you just sit back and think about it, when someone says the word driver, you automatically think of Uber, truck driver, cab driver. You know what I mean? Like, those are instinctively, right, those are instinctively what people think of when people say, I'm a driver. You know what I mean? They don't think of, you know, mom in the soccer van taking the kids home from soccer practice.
Yeah, but
you know what I mean? What's that?
Drive has become a common used term for controlling your private conveyance, and that's not factual.
The thing is that all the terms that we use today in association with what we're doing is they're all commercial.
Right.
Traffic.
Yep.
Transportation.
Correct.
Passenger.
Yep.
Owner, operator, driver. They're all commercial terms. The sticking point in the whole thing is the title property, and that's why, once they have switched title to the vehicle and have made it from an automobile into a motor vehicle, then there's nothing that we can do about it.
When is it an automobile exactly?
It's an automobile when it comes from the manufacturer. Before it's bought, before it is given title to the state or tags and registration and stuff. When the truck driver, let's say he's up in Detroit and he picks up a load of brand new cars, right?
Yeah.
And he's driving these cars from Detroit down here to Miami. And he gets pulled over. Okay, how does the officer know that this gentleman isn't moving a load of stolen cars? Because obviously they've not been tagged or titled or registered yet, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So what he has is what's known as the MCO or MSO, which is the Manufacturer Statement of Origin. It is the absolute and complete title to some vehicle. Okay? Now, when you get down to the dealership, he gets the cars, he gets all the MCOs and MSOs. And state law, when we buy the car, we have to, by law, submit that MCO, MSO to the state in order to get our tags and registered and all that other stuff. And that's what happens. We give them the title to our vehicle, which in title law, if someone's holding your title to your property, it's because they have what's known as a security interest in it, meaning they owe, you know, you owe them money.
Like a lien.
Or some other thing of that nature. So what happens is in title law, when you give somebody a title of your property, it then becomes a split title. And that split title, you have what's known as equitable possession and legal possession. And equitable possession means that you get the possession, and if you sell the item, you get above and over whatever is owed on that item. Okay? And then you have the legal possession, or the legal title, and that means that you get to make the rules for the item. Okay? So that means that you get to say, if it needs two headlights, or if, you know, this has to be done with it, or that has to be done with it. So when we look at the two different titles, equitable and legal, we can see that we have equitable title and the state has legal title, because we have the use and possession of the item, but the state is the one that makes all the rules for the item. like it has to have two headlights and all the brake lights have to be working and no tint, you know, darker than this on the item. So that's how that happens there. Now, once that happens, once that title gets split, your automobile becomes a motor vehicle and everything that you do in that motor vehicle becomes commercial. Doesn't matter if you're just driving from your house to your work. Doesn't matter if, you know, you say you're traveling. Doesn't matter, you know, this or that. That's why all those guys end up losing in court is because they're taking vehicles that have already been transferred over and are regulated and driving those or traveling in them and saying that they're not. But because it's a motor vehicle, it can only be driven. Do you see what I'm saying? Like, there's no way possible that you can travel in a motor vehicle because it's a commercial entity. So, you can't travel in it.
Okay, so can you get a car straight from the manufacturer?
Yes, or what you can do, which would be better, easier, is to just go to the dealership and pay cash for the car. Tell them that you want the MCO and the MSO to the vehicle because you're going to be transferring it out of their jurisdiction and you'll need it to have it titled in the next jurisdiction. You tell them it's the Philippines, whatever. Just say I'm having the car shipped over to the Philippines. I need the MSO, MCO in order to title it over there.
The MSO and the MCO, what's going to keep a cop from, because the cop doesn't know what the hell that means. I just learned it 10 seconds ago.
Right. No, you're definitely going to have issues.
Okay.
It's all going to be with issues. But the simple fact of the matter is now that you've got that MCO, MSO, and it's an automobile, when you go into court to face those issues, you know what I mean? So it's going to be as easy as...
This is not a split title. This is 100% my vehicle. It's not...
Absolutely.
It's not...
This is an automobile.
It's an automobile. It's a private conveyance.
Yeah.
So,
and they know the difference. They know the difference. If you look at, you know, at the state statutes, you can tell that they know the difference because they don't mention automobile one time in the motor vehicle code because they're not dealing with automobiles.
Nothing to do with automobiles.
Exactly.
It's those word games.
Right. That's all it is. That's all it's ever been. If you build your own car, you have the same things. You still have the MSO, MCO, that type of deal.
But there's no paperwork. You built it yourself. You built it in a barn. There's no paperwork.
Right. Well, usually there's going to be. If you have something like an engine that comes with it or a frame that has a serial number, there'll be paperwork with it. There usually is.
Oh.
Even for those build your own car kits, there's usually paperwork because they realize people are usually going to want to get it.
So the best option is to buy a car in cash. Will the dealer actually give you that paperwork you're talking about?
Yeah.
They will?
Yeah.
And they won't get in trouble?
I mean, not really. I mean, when you look at it, it's part and parcel of what you're buying. You know what I mean? Just the same as like a receipt list for a TV that you buy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, this is part of the item that I am purchasing, you know? We should be more pissed that we're not getting this back because what happens is in Florida state law is it says that the state can keep the title up to 10 years, okay? Mm-hmm. And they never send it back to us or they never notify us of this. In fact, they can't send the title back to us because what happens is once they get that MSO, MCO, they photocopy it, they microfilm it, and then they destroy the original so that way you can never get full title back to your vehicle. That's why it has to be a new vehicle that you buy from the dealership.
What about some of these guys who say, I've turned in my license, I've turned in my registration, I've sent letters to the governor? You ever seen that?
Oh, I have. I see them all the time. And my first question to them is, where is the video of you in the car or a transcript of your court case where this line of reasoning and your legal argument was looked upon as what got you off the charge. And again, there's still nothing to this day.
This is on the side of the road is what I'm talking about.
Right, even on the side of the road. I mean, yeah, I've seen some guys that have gotten away with it because the officer, you know, was unclear on the law or something of that nature. But, you know, the true test, again, is getting it through court, you know what I mean? And having, it's like any science experiment, it's got to be repeatable or else it doesn't work.
Right.
So, I mean, if you're going out and you've been driving without a license for, you know, these guys are like, oh, I've been driving without a license for years now. Surely you have plenty of video. Because me and you both know, John, that a cop sees somebody driving without a license plate on there, they're going to get pulled over.
Immediately.
Right. So, obviously, you've had multiple interactions in these last 2 years. Either that or you took the license plate off your car and you parked it behind your barn and you ain't driven it since.
So,
you know what I mean?
Those guys are getting lucky, right, basically. Or they live in rural areas, or they're doing evasive driving, or whatever.
Right, right. And again, if they don't have, you know, this is my thing with those guys specifically, and anybody in the freedom community that says, you know, I'm not a citizen, I revoked my citizenship or something like that, is none of these guys are bringing the proof to the table. You know what I'm saying? Like, for example, if I did this with my car, and I went to court, and the judge was like, you know what, you're right, your car's not an automobile. Dude, I would have some kind of recording of that, you know what I mean? Be it an audio on my phone or a video if they allowed me into it, or I would get the court transcripts or something, because you know what? I would be a fucking millionaire after that, dude. Everybody would want to buy my fucking system of how to beat that shit.
Of course.
You know what I'm saying? So if these guys really are doing that, then they would be doing more than just telling about it and doing that. You know what I mean? It'd be some kind of business model. They'd be teaching seminars. They'd be showing videos of themselves.
They're winging it, basically, and their balls are bigger than their brains.
Yeah. Basically, that's what it was. When I first started looking into that shit, the no license, stuff like that, I told my wife, I said, listen, baby, I said, within 6 months, I'm going to throw away my license, is what I told her. And then after 6 months goes by, I said, you know, I said, after looking into this more, I said, it seems that there's more to it than just what is being put out on the internet by some of these guys. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I had to start looking at it, and it's hard really to question oneself, but I had to do it. You know, so I would go to, like, there's a forum called Quatloos. And there's a forum called Fogmo. And both of these are lawyers and CPA message boards that deal with stuff like sovereign citizens and the right to travel and all this other stuff. And I had to go there and see the cases and see where these people went wrong. And that helped me sharpen up, you know, what was true and what was not true. Because these CPAs and lawyers, they're sheep just like the rest of everybody else. But because they are, you know, the most, you know, ardent non-supporters of the sovereign citizen movement, they can help you reach clarity in your theories because they know what doesn't work already. You know what I mean? They've got the cases to prove it. You know what I mean? They said, you know, if you went in there and said, well, you know, such and such and such with the car, and they said, well, nope, you know, such and such tried that in a court case, blah, blah, blah. And then you go read the court case and you see the court's reasoning why, and then it helps clarify, you know, your theory. And that's how I got it down to, it was actually the title that was being regulated, the item, and it wasn't us being regulated at all. You know what I mean? It was the vehicle that's regulated. And because we're using that vehicle, which is a commercial vehicle, then we thus are regulated as well inside of it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, we're basically all commercial drivers at this point.
Right, because the only vehicle out there for us to drive are commercial vehicles. You know, it would be like only vehicles out there is buses. Nope, we're all fucking bus drivers then, I guess, right?
Right. Let me ask, so you said about court. There's a couple I remember researching. One guy's named Carl Miller. I don't know if you ever heard of him.
Mm-hmm.
And then another guy's named Charlie Sprinkle.
Yeah, Charlie Sprinkle, he actually lost that case, the one against Ronald Reagan and Nancy Reagan and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
He actually lost that case. That's online. You can look that up.
He lost the case, huh? So yeah, the video that he put out where he says, I jumped in my TVP after this lawsuit and went 90 miles an hour, got pulled over, and they told me have a nice day. That's all.
Yeah, I mean, that's either BS or just them trying to, you know, be cool with them or whatever, for whatever reason.
But he ended up losing the case.
Oh, yeah, definitely. He ended up losing.
Okay. He's since passed, right?
Yes, he's passed away now.
What about Carl Miller? What do you know about that one?
I don't know a lot about it that I remember right offhand.
I can't really. He basically, his thing was a license plate. I can't remember offhand either, so we'll get past that. Hey, would you mind if I took the driving, traveling portion of this call and turned it into a podcast?
Yeah, no, that's fine.
Thanks for watching, and what are your thoughts on this conversation? Check out my Etsy store, John's Coin Rings, on Google. Bye-bye now.